Well, good morning. I think I can take this off, right? There we go. Good morning. How are you this morning? Thank you for being here. Thank you for gathering to worship Almighty God. And this day is the second week of Advent. And I want you to direct your attention right over here to this beautiful family as they lead us in the Advent for today.
On the second Sunday of Advent, we light the candle of preparation. The coming of Christ is both a day of judgment and a day of promise. On the second Sunday of Advent, we add to the candle of hope and the candle of preparation. We prepare to meet Jesus either as our Savior or as the judge of our sin.
Isaiah 43:5, a voice of one calling, in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be raised up, and every mountain and hill made low. The rough ground shall become level, the rugged places a plain, and the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all the people will see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has been spoken.
Let us pray. Dear God, we want to be ready for the day of your coming. In Advent's light, help us to see what is important, to be who you want us to be, and to do what you would have us do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Isn't that fantastic? Got to do things differently this year instead of having a big Christmas pageant, and I think that's the best our children's choir has ever sounded, and here's why. I think it's the first time that they've never had the pre-recorded vocal background. That was just all our kids, and that's awesome. Thank you so much for putting that together, tech team and children's ministry team. A couple of announcements this morning before we get into corporate worship in song. Operation Christmas Child box count. The goal this year for Calvary was to fill 300 boxes. As of last reporting, the best Pastor Josh can come up with from all of your input of boxes that were put together, 532. Hallelujah. Just think, 532 kids around the world are going to be impacted by the gospel message of Jesus Christ. Thank you all for your part in that. Coming up, we will have a Christmas Eve service on Christmas Eve, 4:30 p.m. Join us right here. It'll be one service only. So thank you for your attendance on Christmas Eve at 4:30. Pastor Evan, please come up and tell us about the youth ministry schedule for the month.
So students from 6th to 12th grade, we have youth group this upcoming week and next week. On the 16th, we have our Christmas party, so you're going to need to wear an ugly sweater, and if you're against ugly sweaters, wear buffalo plaid flannel like me. But if you don't wear an ugly sweater, you can't win a prize. So there's that. And make sure you bring a gift of no more than $5 for our White Elephant gift exchange. So we're going to meet this week and next week, and the next week is our Christmas party from 6 to 7:30 p.m.
Thank you, Evan. One additional announcement, and that involves giving. We want to continue to encourage you to give, and there's various ways to do so. There's boxes at the back doors of the auditorium where you can put your tithes and your offerings. You can do it by mail, you can do it online at our website, or you can download the Church Center app to your phone, and it's really simple that way. About two clicks and you're into giving, and you just put in your amount and off it goes. So thank you for your continued support of the church. Now, we are counting today attendance very carefully. We have slightly increased the seating capacity of the sanctuary, and if our attendance is within about 20% of what it was last week, between both services, then the elders will be meeting tomorrow night, and we're going to discuss the possibility of next Sunday going back to one service at 10 o'clock, because we believe if people will sit appropriately with only two chairs between you and fill up the room, we can put about 250 people in here and still have space enough. So please be in prayer for us as we decide that, and we're going to count very carefully today and then be in prayer. We just think that that would be a positive step toward the continued attempt to build community within our fellowship. So thank you for abiding by the standards that we have set, and we appreciate your attendance. Thank you very much.
Please stand with us this morning as we worship with through music. You know, watching those kids this morning, they were freely singing, right? All right, we're going to do that this morning. Let's put our hands together as we celebrate Christ. He came, he was a joy to the world. Let's sing together.
Joy to the world. And heaven and nature sing. joy, joy, unspeakable joy, an overflowing well, no tongue can tell, joy, unspeakable joy, it rises in my soul, never lets me go.
Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Amen.
Oh, holy night, the stars are bright. Shining, it is the night of the dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error, pining till he appeared and the soul. The slave is our brother.
this morning. Oh, what a night that was when you came to this world humbly, Lord. You came as a humble little baby to save us. We thank you, Jesus, for your grace and your mercy upon us. Oh, what a night that was. And then, Lord, knowing full well that one day you would go to the cross for us, Jesus. Thank you for your sacrifice, Lord, to bridge that gap for us as mankind. Thank you, Jesus. We come before you this morning, quiet, humbled before you, Jesus. Lead us to the cross this morning, Lord. Lead us there every day, Jesus. Thank you. Amen.
Savior, I come, quiet my soul.
Dear, I count it all as lost.
cross.
You may be seated. Good morning. I'm Mike Sommerfeld. I'm one of the elders here at Calvary. And as we enter into this part of our worship service, our communion service, if you did not pick up your communion cup, it is on the back. In just a minute, you'll have a chance to go and do that. And also, I'd like to say this, what we're going into now is the Lord's table. It's not Calvary's table. If you know the Lord as your personal Savior, we invite you to partake with us as we celebrate this time. And just as a note, with our communion cups, there are two cellophanes. The top one has the bread, and then the underneath one has the juice. So sometimes it's a little tricky, so if you want to prep it now, feel free, you can do that. And then we do have garbage cans that you can throw them into in just when we're finished. At our house this last week, we've been looking at, and I've been noticing we have a little pamphlet that's entitled the Cradle, the Cross, and the Crown. And really, as we think about this time, that is what we're celebrating. You know, two are in the past, the cradle and the cross. And the crown will be coming. One day, we'll see him face to face as our king. But this is a time of remembrance and a time of thankfulness for his death and resurrection. It's also a time of our reflection on our Christian life, and we'll pause. We'll have a word of prayer, and I'll pause for just a moment before I pray. So if there's something that the Lord is laying on your heart, now is the time to make it right. Now is the time to go before him and to confess our sin and to make it right. So as we think about in 1 Corinthians, is where Paul really laid down probably a very basic and clear understanding of the Lord's Supper, he says, let a person examine himself, and then let him eat and drink of the cup. So let's have a time of prayer, and like I said, I'll pause for just a few seconds, a time of silence, and then I'll pray for both the bread and the juice, and then we'll partake of them together as a team, as a church. So let's go to prayer. Father, I just thank you for this time of remembrance. Father, as we think of this Christmas time and all eyes are turned on the baby, which is a very important part, but Father, this is a time when we think about your death and your resurrection. And Father, I want to thank you that you weren't drugged to the cross kicking and screaming. Heavenly Father, thank you that you went to the cross willingly and paid the price that my sin deserves. Father, just thank you for that. And Lord, help us that this would be a time of remembrance and thankfulness for what you have done for each and every one of us. And we do want to give Christ the glory, and we just pray in his name, amen. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he took it, he broke it, and said, this is my body, which is broken for you. this do in remembrance of me. In the same way, also he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
How many of you get excited about Christmas? First hand, right up here. How many of you are stressed out by Christmas? Okay, we have one person. That's pretty amazing. I think Christmas is a time of great excitement, but a mixture of great stress at the same time. This morning, I want to talk about one of the incredible parts of Christmas, which is the gifts, right? All of you have probably been thinking about a list. And maybe your gift is a little different this year. Maybe it's not one you can unwrap. Maybe it's one of health that you're praying for. Maybe it's one of health on behalf of another person or something else that you can't unwrap. But today we're going to talk about gifts that we also can't unwrap, the gifts from Jesus. Last week we talked about the gift of Jesus himself as a baby. And today we're going to talk about the gifts from Jesus. And I want you to put it in the right framework. The gifts that I'm talking about come as a result of salvation in Christ and Christ alone. When you put your faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior, there are other gifts, not because we deserve them, but because that's just the love of God. We get these incredible gifts. And so today we are going to look at the gifts from Jesus. We are going to understand that Christmas is a time of year when we celebrate the promise that God gave to send a Savior and the fulfillment of that promise in Jesus and his life. And we're going to be thinking about those gifts. We're going to talk about five different gifts from Jesus from the book of Romans chapter 5. So if you would turn there, I'm going to read the first 11 verses of Romans chapter 5 as a full passage here. And then as we go through the sermon, we're going to have some kids' involvement. They're going to help us read one verse and we're going to deal with that gift. And then we'll move on and have another kid read that one, etc. So we have some kid theme here today. But if you wouldn't mind standing, if you're able to, in honor and respect of God's word being spoken, we're going to read Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him, we have also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character. And character produces hope, and hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For the one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since, therefore, we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more now that we are reconciled shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. You may be seated. Let me pray. Father God, thank you for this time this morning. Thank you for allowing us the opportunity to gather as one body to worship you, Almighty God. Thank you for this opportunity to put aside all distractions and to focus purely on what you are going to teach us through your spoken word. Thank you for your Holy Spirit who illuminates Scripture for us and helps us understand. We pray that we would come out of this time together understanding who Jesus is more and more and appreciating the incredible gifts that he gives us even though we are so undeserving. We pray it in all your name, Jesus. Amen. One thing that I want you to know right away with reading chapter 5 or the beginning of chapter 5 of Romans is it presents a lot of depth of doctrine to develop your theology. We could go into different words like sanctification, propitiation, substitutionary atonement, all of those things. But today, the five gifts that we're going to talk about are more commonly heard around Christmas, those terms and those gifts, partially to better make it an understandable time for the kids. So as parents, you can take words like peace and joy and love as you see them this Christmas season and have a little bit better understanding of them so you can help teach your kids. You can apply them to yourselves as well. But also because we don't have the time to go into the full depth of each one or any of those terms that I mentioned right here this morning. But it'll give you an outline of some great gifts that we get from Jesus. So the five gifts that we're going to cover are more readily available for you. They're more understandable. But before we get into the gifts, I want you to notice verse 1 of Romans chapter 5 starts with the title of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I want to start here because that's who it's all about. That's exactly who we're dealing with, is Jesus. But notice the term difference, Lord Jesus Christ, very briefly. That word Lord means owner or master. It speaks of Jesus' divinity. So just like last week, we talked about that baby, right? But he's more than just a baby, much more. And so if you need to understand that a little bit better, go back and watch last week. But for today, we see right off the bat, Lord, divine. He's master, followed by Lord Jesus. Jesus, that name announced by the angels, means Yahweh saves, or the Lord is my salvation. It speaks of his mission of salvation. And then followed by Christ, meaning the anointed one, the Messiah. It speaks of his task, his commissioning from God the Father. So we're not dealing with just Jesus as a little baby. We're dealing with the Lord Jesus Christ. That's who we're talking about. So I want you to take notice of that. That's what sets the tone in Romans chapter 5. But let's look at our first gift. We'll see that in verse 1, and I want you to take a listen to the verse from one of our kids.
Romans 5:1. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ.
We have peace with God. Peace doesn't just mean contentment or satisfaction or a time of quiet, right, parents? You want that peace, you're thinking quiet, right? Peace and quiet. But that's not what we're talking about. In this context, it communicates a state of reconciliation. In the Greek, it means to set at one again. Later on in verse 10 of Romans 5, we read this, "For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more now that we are reconciled shall we be saved by his life." And so we're talking about to be set at one. I want you to understand a couple different things. In verse 10, it uses the word enemies. Enemies means that we resisted at one point God's rule over our lives. It's not a way to make us feel bad. It's just the reality. We were enemies with God. We didn't give our full allegiance to God as Lord over our lives. So before Jesus saved you from your sins, before salvation in Christ alone, we were at war with God. We were enemies. Our sin nature made peace with God impossible. Jesus' birth and his death and resurrection gave us an opportunity to once again be at peace with God. That is the peace that we're talking about. We went into depth with that a little bit when we talked about the Prince of Peace last week. But today I want to remind you that the greatest peace that we're talking about through Jesus, the gift from Jesus of peace, means that we are set at one again with God. Just as Jesus said, "My Father and I are one," we can understand that between us and God because of Jesus. We are one with God. We are at peace with him. That's an incredible gift of Jesus. So if we take that knowledge and we kind of go back and paraphrase Romans 5:1, this is what it would sound like. "Therefore, being justified by faith, we are in a place of rest and oneness in our relationship with God because of what our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ accomplished through his birth, death, and resurrection." What an incredible understanding. And yes, I know feelings can be misleading, but what an incredible feeling it is to know the truth that we were enemies with God, but because of Jesus, we are at peace with God. Last Christmas Eve, we talked about the Prince of Peace, and we studied three different types of peace. The first one is internal peace. That's the type of peace that I'm talking about with peace with God. It's that internal peace that no one else could set right except God himself through the power of Jesus and the power of the Holy Spirit. It's that place of position of being at peace with God and a relationship of peace with God because of Jesus. The second type of peace that we mentioned last year that we're recapping is external peace. That's peace with others because our focus is on the most important thing possible, things of the Lord and our salvation. We can be at peace with others. Romans 12:18 says, "If possible, as far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all." That's an external peace with other people because your focus is in the right place. And another part of external peace is peace with the world's circumstances. How in the world can you have peace with what's going on around you in the world? It's because we have this internal peace with God, and our focus is on better and greater things. And so externally, we can demonstrate that peace. And the final type of peace is eternal peace. Our salvation in Jesus is eternal, and it's permanent. This means that we can experience eternal peace. We can have our minds set on that eternal peace right now. That's the type of peace that we're talking about. Billy Graham wrote this, "Someday Christ will come again, and even the evils we still see in the world around us will be destroyed." Yes, someday the angel's promise on that first Christmas will be fulfilled, totally and completely. Peace on earth. That's the eternal peace that we can have our mind set to, but we can understand it and we can focus on it right now. That is what we're talking about with the gift of peace that Jesus provides. He provides peace in all categories of life if we trust him, if we focus our worship on him. So that's gift number one, peace that comes from Jesus and only Jesus. The second one is access to God's favor. We find that in verse 2 of Romans 5, and let's hear one of the kids read verse 2 for us. So through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we stand. So access is a way of or right to approach something. Have any of you ever had a backstage pass somewhere? A couple of you? Yeah, yeah, Matt, no surprise there. Backstage pass. Or maybe you've been to a professional sporting event and you've tried to flag down one of the players. You want to meet them or whatever. Or maybe there's another place like the White House. Have you ever tried to just walk right up and into the White House? You were probably stopped unless you had the right credentials, right? You can't just go certain places without the proper credentials. You can't meet the person that you want to meet unless you have the proper credentials based on who they are and their level of importance. And so when you think about it that way, Jesus and Jesus alone is the person with the credentials for us to meet God. Jesus is the only one with the access to God. We know this because of what we've studied already of who Jesus is and what he's done for us. But let me recap with four different verses. John 14 says, Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Ephesians 2:18, for through him we both have access in one spirit to the Father. Ephesians 3:12, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence through our faith in him. And Hebrews 10:19, therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus. Jesus himself gives us access to Almighty God. So that's what it means when the verse says we have gained access. We now get to have a relationship with God himself because the gift of Jesus. But later on it says, grace in which we stand in that verse. So with that access comes that grace that we get to stand in. So through faith in what Christ did for us on the cross, we receive God's unmerited favor, his grace. I always am overwhelmed when I think about my salvation. The fact that God sent his son and he saved me from my sins, of which I am so deserving of that punishment for my sin. But then God and his love doesn't stop there. It's gift upon blessing and more blessing, and we stand in God's unmerited favor, in his grace. Because of Jesus, we now walk within the realm of God's favor towards us and his blessings upon us. That word stand, when we stand in grace, it refers to our condition or standing before God, not what we deserve, because if we stood before God, we don't deserve grace. We deserve condemnation. We deserve punishment. But because of the gift of Jesus, we stand in God's grace. We stand in a place of favor before Almighty God because of the righteousness of Jesus that's applied to our lives, not because of our own righteousness, as we're reminded in Titus. He saved us not because of works done by us in righteousness. We can do nothing to earn anything from God. It is all because of Jesus that we stand in his grace. When Billy Graham was driving through a small southern town, he was stopped by a policeman and he was charged with speeding. Graham admitted his guilt, but was told by the officer that he would still have to appear in court. The judge then asked him if he was guilty or not guilty, and of course, he pleaded guilty. And then the judge replied, "Wait, I think I recognize you. I'm going to pay your fine of $10, $1 for every mile an hour over that you were speeding. But I'd like to take you to dinner." And he took Billy Graham to dinner and bought him a steak. "That," said Billy Graham, "is how God treats repentant sinners." What an incredible gift, the unmerited favor of God that we get to stand in, not because of what we've done to deserve it, but because of Jesus and only Jesus. So the gift that we've seen already of access to God and peace would be enough, right? But he continues, and we see in the second part of verse 2 of chapter 5 of Romans, the gift of hope. Check out the verse from one of our kids.
Romans 5:2. To him we have also obtained access by faith
stand, we rejoice in hope of the glory of God.
And we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Hope. We talked about it last week or 2 weeks ago with the kids' devotional. The looking forward to something with reason for confidence, respecting fulfillment, expectation, especially pertaining to matters of spoken of in God's promises. It's a future event that is fully expected. It's not wished or wishful thinking. It's confidence that it will. That's the hope that we're talking about. G.K. Chesterton says this about hope. Hope means hoping when things are hopeless, or it is no virtue at all. As long as matters are really hopeful, hope is mere flattery or platitude. It is only when everything is hopeless that hope begins to be a strength. So when we're talking about hope, it's hope in the glory of God. It's with confidence that we get to stand in the glory of God someday in his fullness. That glory of God means that we are thinking and understanding as much as we can his immortal splendor and his revealed perfection. But someday, we won't have to wonder what the glory of God looks like. Right now, we can't understand it fully, but someday we can hope in the future, standing in the glory of God in his fullness. We're looking forward to being in the presence of God and in all of his glory, splendor, and perfection. 1 Peter says this, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you." That is what we have hope in, the glory of God. And we don't have to wish for it. It's not wishful thinking. It is confident understanding that because of Jesus, our position before God is finalized, that we will and stand before God himself in his full glory. We can celebrate that right now. Another gift that we see is the gift of love, and that comes from three verses, Romans 5, 6 through 8. Let's hear one of the kids read that.
"For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." Romans 5, 6 through 8.
So right away in verses 6 through 7, we see a reminder of our condition. And it sets the stage to better understand verse 8 that we'll read or that we saw. In verse 6, it uses the word weak. Different translations use the word powerless or without strength. We were, according to Ephesians 2:12, without hope. There is nothing that we could do. We were not deserving of love. Powerless, weak, without strength, without hope. But Jesus died for us. Jesus died when there was no chance of us confusing that we deserved it in any way, even in the slightest. You see, we weren't partially righteous. We didn't bring a little bit to the table to deserve it at all. We weren't relatively good. No, we were enemies with God, powerless, weak, without hope. And that's what verses 6 and 7 are telling us, so we can best understand verse 8, where it says that God demonstrates his love. Demonstrates means to provide evidence of a personal characteristic or claim through action or to show or to bring something out. And so God's love was proved at the cross. He knows that you're weak, powerless, without strength, and he knows every single embarrassing, humiliating, disgusting sin in your life and in my life, and he still sent Jesus. He still sent Jesus to die because of love. We didn't deserve that. And that love, if you look at the word for in that verse, God demonstrates his love for us. That word for is on our behalf. on behalf of someone, and that person is us. He demonstrates it for us. Mark 10:45 says, "For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." Jesus did not die to make a name for himself, so that people would celebrate him for being so amazing. He already is amazing, but he didn't do it for that reason. He didn't do it for fanfare or to have some big celebration about him. He came not to be served, but to serve. He gave his life. He died for you and for me. That is the love that we see from Jesus. That is the gift. And as a result of that gift of love, we can live. Through Jesus, we have victory over death, and we never die. It is done. It is eternal. It is finished. We have life in Jesus Christ. The final gift that I want you to unpack today comes from verse 11. It's the gift of joy. Let's hear what verse 11 says.
"We also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. More than that,
we rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, the gift of joy. Because we have received reconciliation. Joy, we have to understand, is a fruit of the Spirit. It's not an emotion. It's not determined by circumstances. John Piper says Christian joy is a good feeling in the soul produced by the Holy Spirit as he causes us to see the beauty of Christ in the Word and in the world. It's an all-encompassing state of well-being. Joy is written on our hearts. It's something that can't be taken away. Understanding our starting point that we started with as enemies of God, as being weak and powerless and without strength, it's going to better help us understand what joy is all about right now. Through Jesus, because of Jesus and his reconciliation, we no longer need to be fearful of death, fearful of the wrath of God. We don't need to be terrified of God's almighty power. We need to be in awe, in the fear sense of the word, of his power. But we don't need to be terrified, because it tells us we can rejoice in God because of Jesus Christ. We can celebrate. We can be excited. We can let that joy that's written on our hearts through the power of the Holy Spirit, because we understand our salvation, we can let it come out, whether it's external or not. The spirit of your heart, is it joy because of salvation in Jesus? We don't even have to worry at all if we're saved. If we have salvation in Christ, we don't have to worry. Once we have Jesus as Lord of our life, we can celebrate that life in Christ. It can't be taken away. You've heard me use words like permanent and eternal. Salvation in Christ is forever. You can have assurance that you don't have to die. You can have assurance that that joy is with you forever because your salvation is set. That is where joy comes from. That is joy. R.C. Sproul says the Christian is always in the Lord and the Lord in the Christian, and that is always a reason for joy. We rejoice in the Lord, and since he never leaves us or forsakes us, we can rejoice always. That is what joy is all about. That's what it's talking about. You see, the greatest problem in our life, the one that is incomparably greater than any other problem, we all have it in common. When you think right now of all of the different problems in your life, there is only one that far outweighs every single other problem, and that is sin. You and I have a problem with sin because it keeps us from God. We deserve eternal punishment for that sin. That is the greatest problem that any of us have. Separation from a holy God, no relationship with him. Do you understand that in Jesus Christ through salvation, that that problem is gone? It is dealt with. It is over. It never has to be on your mind again in any form of worry or concern, because it is dealt with and done in Jesus Christ. That realization should penetrate every single thought that we have, and it should become our filter that we view everything else through. And with that mindset, with that spirit of worship, with that understanding, there is something written on our hearts called joy, that we never have to think about that greatest problem ever again. At the risk of making you think that joy is an emotion that is always expressed, I'm going to show you a picture in a moment, but it ties in my understanding that when I think about my greatest problem in life and how it is done and it's over with, when I realize that, this is the expression on my heart, this picture of joy. I think I have it. There it is. This is years ago. My son Liam found the very first Easter egg on an Easter egg hunt. And if you know anything about Liam, he is not reserved and quiet, and he constantly demonstrates passion and excitement. When I was studying this idea of joy and how it is written on my heart and my greatest problem is dealt with in Jesus Christ, this is the expression that my heart has. The pure external demonstration of joy and passion. Some of you aren't as rambunctious as I am, and so you express it more reserved. But whether it is externally shown or not, my question for you, is this what your heart and soul is doing when you think about Jesus Christ? Is this what it's doing when you think about the gifts that Jesus brings to you? Of who he is and what he's done for you? Is that the expression that's happening inside, or is there something else that's gotten in the way of it? We can't go on any longer with a muted sense of understanding of what Jesus has truly done for us. And so many of you have gathered here this morning, you know salvation in Jesus Christ. There's others who go, I've never felt like that in my whole life inside. While I show it to others, there's something inside of me that I can't demonstrate that expression of joy. And I don't know for certain, but I would bet it's because we lack understanding of what Jesus has truly done and who he truly is. And so if that's you this morning, if you're struggling with that expression of who Jesus is, maybe you've never met him as your Savior. Maybe you have never come before him and said, I am a sinner, I am an enemy of God, and I need a Savior. Then today, your heart can look like that. With the realization of your sin, the realization of the punishment that you and all of us deserve. But the fact that Jesus, this beautiful baby boy, the Lord Jesus Christ, came to earth to live a perfect life, to die and go to the cross so that you don't have to. Would you pray with me? Father, the gifts that you give us, we are so undeserving. And Lord, salvation in Jesus Christ, his sacrifice of going to the cross for us, we are so undeserving. We deserve the opposite. Lord, because of your incredible love, you sent Jesus while we were sinners. Christ died for us. And I pray right now for everyone in this place that their understanding of who Jesus is, their understanding of what he did, would have grown today into a deeper knowledge and a deeper joy of what you truly bring to us. And Lord, for those people that don't know you as their Savior, they have never come before Jesus and recognized him as Savior, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, Lord of their life. Lord, if they're in this place right now during this final song, would you get them up out of their seat and send them to the back where there's elders and pastors waiting for them to talk about this incredible name of Jesus and what he's done? If there's people that are watching this via live stream, would you prompt them to call or email or any other way of getting a hold of somebody who knows Jesus Christ? Would you let them understand the joy that we showed this morning of salvation in you? We pray all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. As we close today, I want you to celebrate with our children. Celebrate with our children, making this powerful, impactful statement. about Jesus being king, would you celebrate with the kids? Today and express the incredible joy that you have because unto us a child is born, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, he shall reign forevermore. Amen. Amen. You are dismissed.